It is time for me to go now, but I will not say goodbye. Just look for me in rainbows, way up in the sky. And in the morning sunrise, when all the world is new, just look for me and love me as you know that I loved you. It is time for me to leave you, but I will not say goodbye. Just look for me in rainbows, high up in the sky. In the evening sunset, when all the world is through, just look for me and love me, and I'll be close to you. It will not be forever. The day will come, and then my loving arms will hold you when we meet again. It is time for us to part now, but we will not say goodbye. Just look for me in rainbows, shining in the sky. Every waking moment and all your whole life through, just look for me and love me as you know that I love you. Just wish me to be near you, and I will be there with you. Neville Sylvester Rowe of Baxter's Road, St. Michael, former owner of the Julienne supermarkets at Sky Mall and Bridge Street, St. Michael, and joint owner of NSR Limited, entered peacefully into rest on Tuesday, March 12, 2024, at the age of 73. Neville Sylvester Rowe, son of the late Philip Henry and Eri Elise Young, father of Tremaine Rowe, brother of Esther, Curtis, Maureen, Hallam, and Clifford Rowe, brother-in-law of Shirley Rowe, uncle of Nadine Savory, Emily Rowe, Paul, and Desmond Rowe, great uncle of Rical, Raquel, and Taylor Rowe, and Tariq Ben. Relative of the Rowe, Young, Smith, Moore, Watson, Brooms, Dummett, husbands, Stuart and Hines families. Family friend of Lady Franklin, the Eiffel, Nichols, Bailey, and Jackman families. A friend of Winston Aline, Victor Fernandes, Victor Franklin, Jack Deere, Grant Seeley, the Julienne family, and many others. A service of thanksgiving to celebrate the life of Neville Sylvester Rowe takes place on Tuesday, March 26, 2024, at 2 p.m. in the Chapel of the Coral Ridge Memorial Gardens, The Ridge, Christchurch. The interment will follow in the Summit Gardens. Funeral arrangements have been entrusted to the care of Rose Funeral Service, 10 Goodwood Park, Greamhall, Christchurch. You may join the family for the live streaming of the service and the interment at sharingmemoriesforever.live/Neville Rowe. Thank you.
Didn't know today would be your last, or that I'd have to say goodbye to you so fast. I'm so numb I can't feel anymore. I'm praying you'd just walk back through that door and tell me that I was only dreaming. You're not really gone as long as I believe. There will be another angel around the throne tonight. Your love lives on inside of me, and I will hold on tight. It's not my place to question, only God knows why. I'm just jealous of the angels around the throne tonight. Always made my troubles feel so small. You were always there to catch me when I'd fall. In a world where heroes come and go, where God just took the only one I know. So I'll hold you as close as I can, longing for the day when I see your face again. But until then, God must need another angel around the throne tonight. Your love lives on inside of me, and I will hold on tight. It's not my
Jesus, I believe. Jesus, I believe in you. Jesus, I belong to you. You're the reason that I live, the reason that I sing with
just what is it in me? Sometimes I just don't know. What keeps me in your love? Why you never let me go? And though you're in me now, I've fallen, hurt you still. My Lord, please show me how to know just how you feel. You have forgiven me too many times, it seems. I feel I'm not what you might call a worthy Christian after all. And though I love you so, temptation finds its way to me. Teach me to trust you with all of my heart, to lead not
rejoice. He wraps himself in light.
to hide and trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice. How great is our
good evening to all. Good evening. We're about to begin our pre-service tributes, and they will go as follows. Mr. Paul Rowe, Mr. Victor Franklin, and we also hear from Mr. Winston Allen, and also from Mrs. Jessica Odell Barry. They will come in that order. Thank you.
Good afternoon. I first met my Uncle Neville in 1975 on a vacation visit to Barbados. My uncle took to my brother and I for a few reasons. We were from England and had some heavy English accents. And for some reason, my uncle found that quite amazing and funny. We were both impressionable young boys, and obviously younger than him. What automatically grabbed me at that time, the first thing that grabbed me was his red Toyota Celica. My uncle loved his cars. M1013 was the car number. He went from a red Toyota Celica to a white Supra and a black Toyota Supra. Then he transitioned to the Honda line, Honda Accords, Legends, Preludes. But what really grabbed me, and I saw it on the screen when I came in, because I had a very big afro coming from England, and he had a bigger afro than me. When my parents decided to migrate back to Barbados in 1978, within days of arriving, my uncle called my mom and told her that he's taking out the boys on Saturday. Bear in mind, at this time, my brother was 13 and I was 8. But my mother always trusted my uncle and never objected. Before that, we were going out in the evening or probably the afternoon. We were at home ready, waiting. And then my uncle finally turned up at 11:30 in the night. He told my mom Don't worry. The boys are safe with me. They say confession is good for the soul, so I will confess now. We went to the Empire Cinema that night to watch a Kung Fu movie, 12:30 show. I can vividly remember it right now, The Eagle's Claw. I can safely say that both of us were awestruck for two reasons. One, that we were out at that time at that age, and two, to witness our first Kung Fu movie. The energy that we had was incredible throughout the movie. When we got home, we were actually literally bouncing off the walls. Gran, I want to say sorry to you now because I destroyed your banana trees practicing my Kung Fu. But this was the type of person that he was, my uncle. He was a family person. No matter what the project, no matter what the business, he always found time to spend with his family and his friends. As the years went by, we always remained close. Throughout my school years, I used to, on passing home, visit Julian Lady Care in St. Michael's Row, and we would have some funny conversations. And I remember one time, very close to summer vacation, I popped in and I said to him, hey, I'm going to work at what it was then called Deco Motors for a summer job. My godfather had got this job for me. And he said to me, Paul, why didn't you tell me that you wanted to work? So he said, let me tell you something. Go home, tell your mom and dad that you're not going to know Deco Motors, that you come in and work with me. I said, okay, no problem. And that was the beginning of our personal and professional relationship. And honestly, that was one of the best things that I had as a youngster, being concerned in the world of work. And it was like a family affair. It was people like Gail Jilts, the late Kenneth Giddings, Rosie, Valerie Carter, quite a few. Can't remember all the names, but there were quite a few persons. Throughout the next 10 years, Uncle Neville grew the Julian Lady Care at a rapid rate. He moved from a one-door operation in St. Michael's Row to Tudor Street, Swan Street, Oystens, and then you remember Diamond Tower. The whole mall had a Julian Lady Care, shoe store upstairs, clothes store, and tenanted out the rest. And I remember one evening, late evening, we were on Marhill Street, and he said, let's take a walk. And we went over to Bridge Street, walked over to Bridge Street, and if you remember Bridge Street well at that time in the 90s, there was a supermarket on Bridge Street, and it was a BS&T supermarket. It was a super center supermarket. So take a look inside of it. So I took a look inside, and you know, my uncle was very particular when it came to outfitting stores and being neat and stuff like that. And when I took a look inside of that supermarket, the lights were really dull. It wasn't well packed out, well merchandised. And then he told me, guess what? I said, what? He said, I just bought this supermarket. I said, whoa, because in my mind, I'm looking at this supermarket on Kemp and trying to figure out how this is going to transform. He said, this is what we're going to do. We're going to offer and extend what we did in Julian Lady Care to Julian Supermarket for the people that traverse Bridgetown, to offer them lower prices to keep it going. And I remember there was a lot of chatter in the retail circles because if BS&T had a supermarket that failed in town, it was felt that there was no supermarket that could go in town and succeed. And if you know my uncle, he was intent in proving the naysayers wrong. And boy, did he prove them wrong. Before we actually opened the Bridge Street supermarket, there was a human resource department in the Bridge Street Mall, Diamond Tower upstairs, and there were a series of training sessions to get these young staff ready for it. And one day, my uncle, armed with a Blu-ray player and a Blu-ray movie, came into the training room and said, I want you guys to take out 2 hours of your time to watch this movie. And if you guys are, might have some young people in here might not know what's a Blu-ray now, because some of you guys don't have USB keys, but we watch movies on them, right? So anyhow, we watched this movie, and I remember it very clearly. This movie was a movie named Lean On Me, starring Morgan Freeman. It was about a school that was overrun by gangs and drug lords and really bad children, hooligans, and the teachers were at their wits' end in trying to figure out how they're going to save this school. And through tough love, discipline, teamwork, the school was transformed. And one of the biggest issues that the school has that it was failing its literacy rate. And they improved it and was actually able to improve it. I was trying to figure out, at that point of time, the parallels. But on reflection, it was easy to see why he wanted us to watch this movie, right? So even for me as a young person, I was relatively young at that time, sometimes it was tough to come to grips with his strict nature, but his nature was strict for a particular reason. And on reflection, there was many parallels between the movie Lean On Me and what he was trying to achieve. So what was he trying to achieve? He was trying to shape the lives of young people. He was trying to instill and impart common values to a very young workforce, to dress appropriately and neat, to always come and represent and look sharp. And if you know Uncle Neville, you know he always used to look sharp, right? You could cut yourself on his shirt. To always treat others with respect, to do things with a sense of pride, and develop a strong work ethic. And most importantly, to be part of an organization that impacted society by the cost of lowering the cost of living. I can go on to talk about the birth of Julianne Haggett Hall, but that's another lengthy chapter. What I will say is how symbolic it was that a supermarket was birthed in close proximity to the bust's statue. And let us not forget Julianne's supermarket and the impact the supermarket had on locals and Barbadians. We all know how good the pricing was in Julianne Barbados, but can you imagine pricing being significantly better in Julianne St. Lucia? I can tell you for a fact that almost every weekend there were scores of Barbadians that flew from Barbados to St. Lucia to shop in Julianne St. Lucia and return back to Barbados. That's how significant it was. But for me, it was the little things that made a difference and impacted me. Finding the time to collect me from primary school and secondary school when my mom called and couldn't collect me. That was important. I had a really rough time with asthma growing up. And my uncle researched foods, paid a nutritionist to cook for me every day, and then flew me to Canada to see a specialist along with Rosie to battle my asthma. When I was 18, I had food poisoning, allergic to shellfish. And do you want to know who was at the hospital when I was getting a 15-minute injection? I don't want to tell you where the injection was, but he was right there by my side when I was getting that injection. In closing, I saw so many tributes on social media from friends like Mr. Vic Finance, AKA the market vendor, and many from former Julianne workers that grabbed me because of the real impact on lives. I will just read two in closing. And this one is from Sylvester Smith, posted on March 13th. My career as a graphic artist was birthed and nurtured under Neville's leadership, an unforgettable experience. To all who encountered him, he left an indelible mark. Talk about high standards. This one here is from Vian Lucas, also on March 13th. I worked over 10 years with Julianne Supermarket in the role of supervisor and assistant manager at the Bridge Street and Haggett Hall locations. I worked like a donkey at Bridge Street on the floor. That store used to be packed like a sardine can, and I learned on the job about management and interacted with numerous staff and customers daily. Mr. Leverow built a great team, and many of the management and staff moved into their own businesses or operated their own stores after leaving. Mr. Rowe's vision for his business was beyond normal expectations, and his standards exceptional. He was by no means an easy person to work with, and I cannot count the number of times he threatened to fire me. If there's one thing you know about my uncle, he would say that, but he had a very soft heart, huh? I left Julianne in 2001 with knowledge and business etiquette. I refused to continue working in retail, but I knew if I had chosen to pursue retail, the knowledge and business etiquette I had learned with Julianne, I will be a tower in any organization. Thank you, Mr. Navarro. May you rest in peace, Uncle.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. This here is a positive information by Swami Vivekananda, and it reflect on the man Neville Rowe. And it goes like this: take up one idea, make that one idea your life. Think of it, you dream of it, you live on that idea. Let the brain, your muscles, the nerves, every part of your body be full of that idea, and just leave every other idea alone. This is the way to success. And that's how Neville operated. This afternoon, we are gathered here to pay our final respect to one of Barbados' leading entrepreneurs who started from the ground up and reached the zenith when he opened Mall International, now known as Sky Mall in Hackett Hall. He is the late Neville Sylvester Rowe. When I was 19 years of age, I caught the newspaper bug and became an advertising executive at the Barbados Advocate newspaper, and also chipping in as graphic designer for my clients. In 1983, I received a call from a client who was interested in advertising in our newspaper. The client asked, "Sir, will you be able to meet with me within an hour?" He didn't care what he was doing, within an hour. I said, "Yes, sir, I will be there." That client turned out to be Mr. Neville Rowe, Barbados' youngest supermarket magnate. I arrived early and spoke to a lady, informing her that I have an appointment with Mr. Rowe. The lady said with a smile, "He's on the floor, and you will see a gentleman in long sleeve, white shirt, with a tie, black pants, white socks, and black shoes." It never changed, you know. Even on Sunday, something happened, he dressed like that. Anyway, this lady knew her boss well and refused to inform me that he had long Jerry curl hair. That's the respect he commanded. That was the start of our association. Mr. Rowe was a giant of business ethics with a determination to succeed. Let me tell you up front, Neville, as he allowed me to call him, stated that he will be constructing a new building called Diamond Tower on Marhill Street, and he will need advertisements to coincide with its opening. That was the beginning of a 40-year working relationship with this supermarket visionary. Unfortunately, in 1990, fire destroyed some of the stores at Diamond Tower, including supermarket, and within a few months, this goal-getter was able to construct a new supermarket that covered the entire floor space on Bridge Street. That is the power of an entrepreneurial appetite who fails to say never. Again, I was up and down with Mr. Rowe, ensuring the feature will be ready for the opening. By the way, I must inform you that two VFs, V, first name, F, second name, were the mastermind of all advertisements for Julien. Vic Fernandes did all the voiceover, and I, Victor Franklin, did all the printed advertisement for the two newspapers, along with sponsored ads for any magazine. If anyone need an advertisement from his business, he informed them to speak to Mr. Franklin. That was who Mr. Rowe was. He always made sure that he remained with one person. He don't jump from here, there, or anything like that. In late 1998, while he's compiling information for the newspaper, Mr. Rowe paused. As cool as a cucumber, he said, "Frankie, I'll be opening a mall of all malls in Hackett Hall to be called Mall International." Luckily, it was close to my home. I was able to see the massive undertaking of the largest supermarket in Barbados and the Caribbean. Neville was articulate. He stopped the opening many times to add on a bit here and a bit there, and ignore the pleas of the architect to stop and open the complex. The gentleman realized the respect between Neville and myself and asked me to speak to Mr. Rowe. I was also in a predicament in getting the opening ready for the feature. I told Neville, we have to stop here and get ready to open. Neville said, everything look okay, Frankie? Cool and simple, I respond, I'm impressed. We all walk around this huge complex from top to bottom to ensure the supermarket area was ready for business. One day, Neville out of the blue veered away from the advertising discussion and with the seriousness of a teacher, said, Frankie, don't let anyone feel that you are poor. Be immaculately dressed, hair well groomed, shoes shining, and shirt tucked in your pants, with matching tie, and everybody will feel you are rich. Boy, oh boy. And you will be treated with dignity. You know something? He was right. Because if you go into a place, even if you start working and you look shabby, you'll be treated shabby. So you have to make sure that you walk with dignity, and this is Neville walk. Hand in this pocket, and he can be walking up and down in this supermarket. He was something else. Ladies and gentlemen, that was who Neville was, a private, honest two-man business mogul who did it his way. Rest in peace, my brother. My wife, Peggy, who he always gives a big hug. My twins, Kim and Kelly. And San Andrew, extend our condolences to this outstanding son of the soil. Tremaine, you have started to follow in the footsteps of your dad to be an entrepreneur, an immaculately dressed son. Your Aunt Esther and immediate family will always be your protection. Neville, we are going to miss you. Guest, thanks to everyone.
Sylvester Rowe, my friend, by me, Winston Allen. Neville and I met in his store, Julien, on St. Michael's Row, after they had squeezed through the burgeoning crowd, getting their purchases. This is soon after my involvement in starting a black business, Celebration Corporate Credit Union Limited, an organization of which he later became a member. I was a graphic artist with one of the leading advertising agencies, Smith & Oxley Advertising. So my artistic eye caught the shelf talkers and what appeared to be a logo. I asked, what does this logo represent? As it was to me, not clearly defined. Then I asked if he had corporate colors. He said no. I also pointed out that those pieces of card with handwritten prices could be improved. He then said, well, you do something and let me see what it could look like. And I did. The word Julie was the mother of Neville's son, Tremaine, with the N for Neville completing the logo. A female head was introduced, representing the products he carried, and tilted towards the sky to indicate that the sky was the limit for this business. We then used the same corporate colors as the new organization we had just established for City of Brisson Corporate Credit Union. Purple, green, and black. The purple, the regal color, green to show the luxuriance of growth, and black to show solidity. As you can see, percentages of these colors were used throughout the buildings he subsequently erected. He was extremely excited when he called me to say that he had just bought a piece of land, 5,000 square feet on Marhill Street. I'm coming to take you to see it. We went, we viewed the area. This is where Diamond Tower was built. He asked me to design the logo of the diamond, which was to be placed on the side wall facing the Duncan O'Neill Bridge. Then he said, I'm looking to build something bigger and better than anything you see in Barbados. This is when he acquired the Barnes Building on Bridge Street, where he established the Bridge Street Mall. We met at his house and we spread out the plans on the floor and he explained the layout and the rest is history. To my surprise, his innovative mind conceptualized an even bigger project at Haggett Hall, which he said was going to be beyond my imagination. Again, we met in his living room and these drawings took up the whole floor. He told me the amount he was hoping to acquire for this project, which he planned to repay in 7 years. 7 years? People get mortgages for a fraction of that and have 30 years to repay it. I said, this is ambitious. He said, you have to think big. The memories I cherish even more are those evenings he would call to say, meet me by the barn in Cavins Lane. We got to stock up the storage of products for when the staff come in tomorrow morning. He, Kenneth Gittins, now deceased, and myself would form a chain tossing products to fill up the vehicles we drove to the barn. Sometimes Esther would be there keeping us company. Never always believed in good presentation. And this was reflected in the way he carried himself, always impeccably dressed and groomed. Everything had to be in place. He told me that there were certain projects that he could not go to the traditional financial institutions to finance. Hence, he became a member of COB Credit Union and executed those projects through his credit union. Right, yeah, Neville wasn't one to waste time. He never wasted time. And people say that they never really heard his voice because he was very laconic. He wasn't a person for talking a lot. But he was a deep thinker, and he knew what he wanted to do. After designing certain things for Neville, he decided, I want to do in-store promotions and so on, and I need to have them done like yesterday. So Neville established his own art department with some very talented young people, and he brought in state-of-the-art equipment to do his posters, to do his newspaper ads, and everything was done when he wanted it, how he wanted it, so that everything was on time. You didn't have to wait on anyone because that was their job, just to create these things when they were needed. So he was one of those persons, he believed in making the best use of the time he had, and whatever it took to get the thing done, he made sure he got it done. So he's one of those people that I admired for that. My only regret is that I did not follow through to document his life and business progress for this country's posterity. He has single-handedly transformed the business landscape in this country. He was admired as well as envied. And when the history of black business is written, he would be undoubtedly recognized as one of the greatest entrepreneurs this country has ever produced. He has set the bar exceedingly high for others to follow. He truly was a visionary who, daring against the odds, lit the path to inspiring business persons and did it his way. May he rest in peace.
I would like to thank Mr. Winston Aline. He's here. Thank you so much, Mr. Aline.
We will now have a tribute from Mrs. Jessica Odell Barile, Director of Protocol from the Prime Minister's Office.
Pastor Tremaine, the entire Rowe family, ladies and gentlemen here gathered, I have been introduced as Prime Minister Motley's Director of Protocol, but I've come here today as perhaps one of the longest serving service providers and friend of our friend who we send home to rest today. Yes, I do occupy the other official position, but I am here on my own accord. We have heard words about Neville regarding excellence, determination, visionary, caring uncle, fabulous dad, I know, loving brother. I want to add to those honest, straight talking friend. When I opened business with Linda, my Odell, my sister-in-law, who's also here, 47 years ago, Neville Rowe, and you know, always a discreet man, so I'm not talking about your business now, Neville, but was one of our first clients. And there he remained to the end. Tremaine will tell you that he ensured that he got Neville where he needed to be when he needed what he needed. And we will not go into details about his needs. And so our relationship of that honest, transparent has survived many decades. I learned a lot from this discerning businessman, not afraid to butt heads his way and to achieve much in this country. I'm also aware of the tremendous challenges that he would have faced because he dared to challenge the status quo. I won't define status quo this evening, but I think we all know what we refer to when we're talking about business in Barbados. I come from a family whose father dared to challenge the status quo in 1952 and had to put the home on the block for the bank when cement came in those days in the belly of a ship. Had that ship sunk? I put it this way, my father's four snotty-nosed kids, including me, would have been on the street. I don't know how much further we have advanced between 52 and the early 1970s when Neville started. I know significant steps have been made, but they've been made because the status quo has been challenged by people like Neville Rowe. They've been challenged because people like, I'm going to call names, Vic Fernandes, was not afraid to be bold enough to be a part of a successful and winning team. And there are many others. The previous speaker who I saw yesterday, and we had a quiet chat about today's proceedings. So in the 1970s, it wasn't easy. Young black men did not open supermarkets. My brother, who was one of Neville's co-partners early in business, knows this, and they took the heat for it. But he sustained and survived against many odds. I have to say, though, that my presence here really is on the personal note, because Neville, as we have heard many times, was an exceedingly private person. Neville didn't tell you where he lived, and if you were ever invited there, consider yourself fortunate. I was blessed so to have been done probably more than 30 years ago, and you would have thought you were in New York City, right there on Baxter's Road. His detail and eye for excellence was ever present. In those years when I went to build my home, he called me aside and said quietly, "Do you have a security system in the house?" I said, "Neville, can't afford a security system. No, the bricks and mortar alone carry me down to the wire." He said, "Listen to me, put in a security system. You have bars?" I said, "I wasn't going to put in the bars. I was going to put sash windows like these here." He said, "Don't worry about that, put in bars." Do you know, I followed his every instruction. And to this day, I have to say there are no regrets, even at the time when it was challenging financially to do so. But he called me aside very quietly and said what he had to say. He also called me aside as a young business person. I think we may be similar in age. No, he got the edge on me a little bit, just a little. And he said, "You know, when you want something in this life, go to the head of the spring." I repeat that, go to the head of the spring. Neville and I never discussed politics, ever. But when I became the candidate for the Barbados Labour Party in 1994, everybody knows you got to do what you got to do to get that campaign going. I went to the head of the spring. I was very clear with whom I was running. I never asked him where his support lay, and it wasn't my business because our friendship was not defined along political lines. But it was based on trust and belief, and he believed that I could do something, and I had his support, and I am forever thankful for that. And never once did he come to me and say, "You know, I did so-and-so, so you need to do so-and-so." That is the man I'm talking about. So across boundaries, regardless of treatment, he treated you as he met with you. And today I am the better person for knowing someone like Neville Rowe. The last time we spoke, again, part of his training, I no longer work in that place. where he received services. But I went by, and there he was. I was actually having a service myself done, and I was in a particular chair. When it was his turn to come into that space, I remembered that is his chair. He always used the same seat every time he came to our establishment. Girls, do I lie? And it came to me suddenly, and I jumped up and I said, no, you have this one. Again, he called me aside. He said, that is why I love you. Because you take the time, I don't know how you remember this, but you take the time to make sure that people feel important. And you knew I like to sit there. I said, because that is how we are. That is how our relationship is. And so there was a soft side of Neville, all of that story to tell you, that few would ever see. Because he would never be boastful, never bragging. Took the time for those who mattered to go to your ear and give you that value of his experience and advice. I never heard Neville Rowe once bemoan and complain, or go on brass tacks, if I did, I missed it, to complain about how things in Barbados treating him. If he fell down, he fell on his back, and he looked forward to continue that dream. And that is what I believe, at least one of the lessons that we must take from the life that we have tonight, this afternoon, come to celebrate. Yes, to celebrate. Even though he told me he was going to lift 100. Neville, your math is off. He told me 100. He told anybody else 100? He told some others forever. And it's on that note that I will say the memory of Neville Rowe would live on forever. The former speaker said when the history is written about black entrepreneurism and business in Barbados, his name must rank high among others unsung heroes and heroines. And so today, if we take nothing away from this very large gathering for this service, Pastor, maybe in your remarks, you would encourage us that by your living you shall be known. And that if we take away some of the excellent lessons that we have observed, heard of, and experienced from Neville Rowe, our lives could only be better. And on a parting note, if you are an aspiring business person in Barbados, young or old, black or white, male or female, or whatever you choose to be, use some of the tenacity of the Neville Rowes of this world and do your stuff. May he rest in peace, and I know may God allow him to rise in glory. Thank you.
Make a way for me. He me closely to his side. With love and strength for each new day, he will make a way. He will make a way. With love and strength for each new day, he will make a way.
Neville Sylvester Rowe. Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth be removed, and though the mountains be carried into the sea, though the waters thereof roar and be troubled, though the mountains shake with the swelling thereof. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. For whether we live unto the Lord. And whether we die unto the Lord. We brought nothing into this world, and it is certain we will carry nothing out. The Lord gave and the Lord taketh away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. For I am persuaded neither death nor life, nor angels nor principalities, nor powers nor things present, nor things to come, nor height nor depth, nor any created thing shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus. Let us pray. Almighty God, in the midst of life we are in death. Of you we seek comfort, but in you, whose only Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by his death and resurrection, has conquered death for us. Out of the depths of our griefs and loss, we turn to you praying that the light of your countenance will now shine upon us, and a sense of your presence will strengthen us, and the reality of your promise of eternal life will console us. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. O Lord, be with us in this hour of need of loss. Let not our faith fail, our hope grow dim. May we now perceive the shadow of your hand outstretched in love. And may the ministry of your Holy Spirit surround us with the hope of heaven with you forever. Now thanks to him who lives, though he was dead, and behold, he is alive forevermore. Let us now repeat the prayer that our Lord Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. I join with the psalmist this evening to say, oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good, for his mercies endure forever. This evening, we are gathered here to give Almighty God thanks for the life of Neville Sylvester Rowe. I did not know him personally, but we know him as a brother, a father, a nephew, an uncle, and as you would have heard in the pre-tributes, an outstanding businessman and friend. And no doubt he would have touched the lives of many. And we thank God this evening for the invaluable contribution, the unwavering commitment that he would have made to business. We thank all of you who are here this evening, who have joined the family, and those who have come to give of your support. And all specially invited guests, we welcome you. At this time, on the behalf of the board and the members of the Guiding Light Tabernacle Ministry, where his sister Esther, our sister Nadine and Terry attend, I would like to extend to all of you, especially the family, our deepest heartfelt condolences to the family. As we continue in this service, we pray for God's comfort and strength at this difficult time. The first hymn on your hymn sheet, Great is Thy Faithfulness.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not, thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast
truly this evening we can say, great is the faithfulness of our God. We give God praise and we give him thanks. At this time, Miss Esther Rowe, she's going to come and give her remarks. And following that will be the eulogy by Mr. Tremaine Rowe.
Good afternoon. I really would like to thank each and every one of you that have taken so much time out of your busy lives today to come and say farewell, goodbye, whatever your heart may desire to Neville. I thank you. I'll give you a little synopsis that happened. Tremaine and I were with Neville when he passed. I never saw anything happen so fast. It made me know that life was very fleeting and very fragile. I laid on his chest crying. I hoped to hear a heartbeat. I didn't. I sat on a chair, looked at his chest. I thought I saw it move. I ran back to him. I laid there praying and hoping that all would be well. I didn't want to believe the news that the doctors had just said. Finally, the funeral director came, and when I saw them take him off the bed, that ripped something out of me. That was the last time I saw Neville until yesterday and today. But I've asked the Holy Spirit to fill that void, because that's the only thing that will keep me. I love Neville, and Neville loved his sister. Neville loved people. So much so that he loved being of service to people. I would dare say he loved his Julianers, even though they might have felt at the time that he was so firm on them. He loved you all. I would like to implore and ask anyone that is hearing my voice today, whether it's social media, here in this chapel, any place that Neville's friends are all around the world, to make sure that if the Lord comes today, that you're ready. Just make sure that your election is ready. That is the type of man that Neville was. I would ask you to be selfless, unselfish, humane, and most of all, kind to everyone. Pay it forward and it will come back to you. Whether it's you, your children's children, or their children. But it will come back to you. And looking around today and seeing the gathering that is here for Neville, I'm sure he's smiling, and I say thank you. So when it is all said and done, we are here, and Neville is going to leave us. But there is still a God that will keep us. Now, couple of days after Neville passed, I received a little note from someone on WhatsApp, a friend of mine. And I read it and it warmed my heart. And I called her back and I said, I love this. I'm going to laminate it and keep this in honor of Neville. And then I said to her, you know what? Who is the author? And can you call him and ask him or her if I can read this ode at Neville's funeral? She called me back about 8:30 night time and she said, you have his permission and he's honored. So today, I read an ode to Neville Rowe from the author, former minister, Mr. Ronald Jones. And the title is A Beacon of Resilience. O Neville, from humble soil you sprang, a black businessman, strong and resolute. Faced with hurdles, you stood undeterred, establishing businesses where the underserved found hope. Julien's, a beacon bright in the business sea, laid the stage for your grand expansion to Haggett Hall. You, a visionary, crafting dreams for all to see, but forces conjoined sought to push you against the wall. Yet in the face of adversity, you stood tall, a proud descendant of a pantheon, strong and true. Annie Wilson, James Tudor, Anne Delight, Edwin Worrell, Gertrude Eastman, names that grew. Roald Brinker, Lloyd Allain, Hal Bushell and more, a league of trailblazers against the odds they fought. Climbing peaks, forging paths never trodden before. You, Neville Rowe, amongst them, courageously sought. Proudly you led the way, a torch bearer for all. A symbol of triumph against the forces that would sway. In the annals of history, your name shall stand tall. For in your journey, courage was the guiding ray. So here's to Neville Rowe, a man of vision and might, who like a phoenix rose from the challenges so deep, a legacy etched in the fabric of the night, a testament of courage for all to cherish and keep. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Tremaine Rowe, and I'm just going to ask you to allow me just a few moments of your time to pay respects to my dad, the awesome Mr. Neville Rowe. Neville Sylvester Rowe was born on the 24th of January, 1951, to the parents of Henry Philip Young and Harry Elise Young, predeceased. He was the fifth child of the union and the last boy in the family. As a young boy, Dad was quite a handful. He got into everything, and most of all, he loved going to the beach, of which he was warned by Granny constantly to stay away. But no, he just had to go. So he and Auntie would scale the paling in the backyard. And this paling was pretty high. He would take off to the beach and she would stay and pitch marbles with the boys until he came back. Much to their detriment, they did not know that Granddad would come looking for them in the yard, only to peep through the paling and see Auntie and Noah Neville. But he was waiting on both of them with lashes galore. You think that stopped him? Nope. Every time he would scale that paling, either right there at the back of the house pitching marbles with Auntie, or you know where, the beach. Dad became an entrepreneur very early, helping in the family business, which was called Young Sweets Parlor, and then Young Supermarket Limited. He stepped out courageously and began making earrings with his brother Hallam, who taught him the trade. Moving on from that, he opened his first store in Baxter's Road, named The Shack. This business did extremely well, and eventually, the first Julien boutique materialized. At that time, being a very astute businessman and blessed with great vision, Dad saw the need to open more branches, expanding into the region, St. Lucia, with a view of helping people who needed it most. Thus, Julien was known for its low prices and being called the people's choice. Coming from humble beginnings, one could say that Haggett Hall is a monument and testimony to the legacy of Neville Rowe, which will be acknowledged for many lifetimes. To many people, he was a mentor, a good boss, a friend, but he was the best son a mother could ever want. He took care of Granny throughout her lifetime, and in her sickness, he was always there lovingly and financially for her. He loved people from all walks of life, and Dad's success over the years can be measured by the lives he touched. He was greatly loved by his family, those who surrounded him, and many more. He was a no-nonsense person. You could not approach my dad with negativity. He just did not like to entertain it. And if there was a problem, he would always be focused on seeking the solution as quickly as possible. He was the epitome of determination, efficiency, and professionalism. Dad was one of a kind. He could add up numbers in his head before you could say Jack Sprat. And as a visionary, conceptualize his businesses. On a light note, Bobby Fernandes told Auntie of a time when the electricity had gone off at Bridge Street Supermarket and the store was packed with customers. Dad wanted to get the customers out quickly, so he provided calculators to help. The cashiers would call out the prices and they added up. Mr. Fernandes said that Dad calculated the items faster than they who had calculators, adding that he had gifts from the Almighty God. Through the years, he acknowledged these gifts and he would set aside time each day to pray to the Father. But Auntie, not witnessing or ever hearing him accepting the Lord as Savior, made sure that Dad was going to be in the family group upstairs. So she got him to say the sinner's prayer and accept Christ as his Lord and Savior. Dad was always a peaceful soul and to the end remained the same. Dad never liked to waste time. As soon as the idea came into his head, he wanted to work on it. And that was very true. Even for the last few weeks, it was crazy. You know, anything that he had to work on, he just wanted to discuss it. Anyway, so as soon as the idea came into his head, he wanted to work on it. He established his in-house art department to SBI promotions at Julien Supermarket. From newspaper ads to in-house posters, this art department was outfitted with great equipment, state-of-the-art, and ensured that advertising was homogenized through the branches. Mr. Yearwood, who was in charge of this department, took the lead from his boss, Mr. Rowe, and produced exceptional work. Dad got exceptional assistance from professionals the likes of Vic Fernandes, Jack Dare, and Victor Franklin, to name a few, who'd helped script and voice numerous media ads. He then gave the go-ahead, once he was satisfied, to all parties, and he was off to the races. Another great professional that my dad worked along with was Mr. Willie Allen of Willie Allen Associates Photography Limited, who has recently passed. We would like to pay homage to Mr. Allen, as he was a close friend of Dad, knowing that from inception, he was always there at every beck and call for the company. Almost every photograph that we are privileged to see here today, whether in our leaflets or on the montage of Julien, or the corporate photos of Neville and his immediate family, were the production of Mr. Willie Allen. May he rest in peace. May we have a small moment of silence for him. Thank you. On a more personal note, my dad, Neville Rowe, the family man, was pretty cool. At the even, I got my fair share of lashes. Oh yes, I did. But I also remember the long drives on Sundays that we would take together around the island, listening to the golden age of music with hit after hit, from the Supremes, Motown legends, Aretha Franklin, Brooke Benton, Diana Ross, Kenny Rogers, Percy Sledge, Benny King, Michael Jackson, and the Jackson 5, and much more, only to end up with Granny for Sunday lunch. One thing I remembered him loving on his plate was a slice or two of sweet potato. He loved sweet potato and an ice cold Coca-Cola. Neville always loved to dress well, and we all knew his dress code. White shirt, black pants, tie, and shiny shoes. And this is what he wore for many years. It reminded me of a scene in Men in Black when Agent Z said to Will Smith, "Let's put it on." And Will Smith said, "Put what on?" And Agent Z responded, "The last suit you'll ever wear." I'll show you how serious it was. If my dad needed to move his car out of the driveway for any reason, just to go downstairs, it was white shirt, black pants, tie, and shiny shoes. Again, I'll show you how serious it was. When he used to take me to fly kite at Easter with my mom at the Garrison, or even at UE, it was black shirt, black pants, white shirt, tie, and shiny shoes. Consistency. That is one thing I remember about my dad. And for Navarro, presentation was key always. Dad loved marketing. It was his thing. So much so that I remember the days we would sit down together just watching TV. Not for movies, but switching channels to watch ads and pick out what was good or bad about them, or what stood out in the visuals or catchphrases, and how their direct or indirect story composition would impact the viewer. It was actually fun, even though I find myself doing the same, or looking at packaging of products anywhere I go. His insights and marketing mind were just astounding. He was a lover of greatness and really respected people that I could only refer to as legendary achievers, performing at the highest level. Michael Jackson, Bruce Lee, Nelson Mandela, Bob Marley, Serena Williams, President Barack Obama and Michelle Obama, Tiger Woods, Usain Bolt, to name a few, and Rihanna. Oh, he loved Rihanna. I believe it was her focus, dedication, and speed that she grew out internationally that intrigued him. However, there was one more person that Dad totally respected. When it came to basketball, which he loved so much, there was only one person he was backing. His favorite player was the great Michael Jordan. And I remember back in the day, him always being excited to watch a Chicago Bulls game. Lights off, volume up, and him enjoying every moment. Win or lose, he bought number 23, Michael Jordan. I saw my dad as a hard-working legend. I cannot tell you the countless nights, and I mean countless nights, I would witness him awake to wee hours of the morning, 3, 4, 5 o'clock, working on price changes to be inputted in the system the next day. Then at the store in the art department, looking over the way shelf talkers looked. And trust me, I heard from Mr. Yearwood himself the amount of times he had to redo them, drawing from scratch with markers. The many meetings that he would take throughout the day to advance the business and the brand Julien. The trips to countless international trade shows and suppliers to bring in amazing products at excellent prices so that the end customer could be happy and receive true value. The meticulous attention to detail he took when walking through Haggett Hall as it was being built to make sure it was a masterpiece for every person who would come through those doors or see it from the highway as they drove by in all directions. One thing I saw throughout this entire process is that he spared no expense. Not because he liked fancy, expensive things. That was not even his motive. The real driving force that he would always mention to me, and I remember this, this is all for the customers and staff to be comfortable and have an excellent experience. It's all about them. From supreme architecture, having a lukewarm finishes, excellent skylighting, glass paneling, and marble finishes even in the bathrooms, to all equipment needed for operations to run efficiently internally, a whole lot of checkout stations which were never enough at Christmas and holidays, to excellent prices and phenomenal giveaways of cash, house, land, cars and appliances. And on a side note, looking through some photos of the stores, I saw a picture of $75,000 cash being given away. And this was years ago in the 90s. I was truly stunned. From brilliant staff training sessions and often awesome staff award ceremonies to the Julianne Walk, staff vehicles, excellent wages and salaries, to hiring in those times one of the largest staff complements on the island and so much more. All this he accomplished, but not alone. And I repeat, not alone. And we'll always talk about the Julianne staff and customers with great admiration. It was about each and every one of us. And as a result of this, I would like to thank every individual who made Julianne Superstores what it was, what it is in our memories, and allowed my dad to smile internally and externally, day in and day out, with the difference he made and was able to make by using his humble God-given gifts to serve us all. For us, Dad's passing has been very difficult, as Auntie and I were with him at the hospital when he took his last breath. He had the best patient care from his doctors, Dr. Carla Goddard, Dr. Chris Nichols, and the nurses who were always there for him and with us. His legacy will live on as being a visionary, confident decision maker, dynamic in nature, and definitely a caring person. It is a goodbye for now, Dad. You will always be loved and dearly missed. I know that you and Granny are smiling down on this gathering today and giving your approval over this farewell. On behalf of my aunt, I say sleep well, dear brother. On behalf of my Uncle Hallam, Uncle Curtis, Uncle Clifford, and Aunt Maureen, I say rest in peace, brother. On behalf of all other family, friends, acquaintances, both locally and internationally, Julianne staff, customers, everyone here physically, online, or in spirit, I say sleep in peace, Mr. Navarro. And for me, I wish you to rest in peace, Dad. I love you. I really do miss your awesome presence. Thank you for listening and for being here today.
We want to thank Tremaine for that wonderful tribute about his dad. At this time, we'll have the first Bible lesson, Ecclesiastes chapter 3, 1 through 8. It will be read by Mr. Ronnie Graves Starr. Can we stand for that reading?
Good evening. To everything, there is a season, and a time to every purpose under the heaven, a time to be born, and a time to die, a time to plant, and a time to pluck up that which is planted, a time to kill, and a time to heal, a time to break down, and a time to build up, a time to weep, and a time to laugh, a time to mourn, and a time to dance, a time to cast away stones, and a time to gather stones together, a time to embrace, and a time to refrain from embracing, a time to get, and a time to lose, a time to keep, and a time to cast away, a time to rend, and a time to sue, a time to keep silence, and a time to speak, a time to love, and a time to hate, a time of war, and a time of peace. Here ends the reading.
You may be seated. We will now have tributes following in this order. Mr. Jack Dare, Mr. Victor Fernandes, and Mr. Terry Ben, and Ms. Nadine Savory.
Good afternoon. We have lost a great man. Barbados has lost a great man. So said Mohamed Nasser, as he called in to the radio program. I couldn't agree with you more, Mr. Nasser. He was definitely a great man. Neville impacted not only everyone here today, he impacted Barbados tangibly in a most visible expression. No matter what name the building in the shadow of the Emancipation Statue goes by, to Barbadians of a particular generation, when you pass that complex in Hyatt Hall, you think Julien and Neville Rowe. For the younger generation, and perhaps surprisingly to many of you, I shall paraphrase Jay-Z. Neville was not just a businessman, he was a businessman. I began working with Neville Rowe in the latter half of the 90s, producing his TV commercials and television programs. Neville was a perfectionist. His concern for detail was remarkable. From his hair to his black pants and belt, crispy white shirts, carefully curated ties, shiny black shoes, and a Colgate smile. A perfectionist, yes, but always a man of the people. While he had an office, you often found him interacting with staff, friends, and strangers on the floor. Neville once told me that his goal was to put out an exceptional product that was affordable. He cared about style, but more importantly, he was a man of substance, a man of the people, a man for the people. Beyond politics and optics, Neville was definitely a man of the people. Neville always remembered this, and I know he passed it on to his son, whom I know he is proud of. Tremaine didn't inherit a title or role. He worked for it. He started bagging groceries and learning the business from the ground up. I'm also proud of you, Tremaine, and consider you a friend. Was he a dreamer? Of course, Neville was a dreamer. But unlike so many dreamers, he made his dream a reality. Neville once told me that this dream was to sell fully cooked rotisserie chickens in the supermarket, which were cheaper than buying a whole chicken. I didn't know how he did it, but somehow he managed to sell those chickens for $12, and they were very delicious too. Neville did everything with that spirit of perfectionism, professionalism, and care. We produced many commercials and a weekly TV program. Some days we began before 7 a.m. and would finish or pause at 2 or 3 a.m. the following day. We often took lunch after 9 p.m. Through it all, Neville was the last to leave. Still somehow, hair still perfect, shirt tucked in. Paul Rowe and George Connolly would know about this. Once while shooting a promo for Julien in front of his carefully assembled fruit and vegetable display, he looked at the video monitor and cleared his throat. Then he said, "Jack, look at this. That apple, the one over there, I'm taking it out of the shot. It doesn't look good. It must go." It was one apple. And this was before high definition. We would never have noticed. But Neville did, though. You see, he didn't match his perfectionism, professionalism, and care. It didn't. When the boss said it had to go, it had to go. We all must go at some time, regardless. I'm sad to see you go, my friend. Unlike that apple, you belong in the shot. The snapshot of Barbadian history will forever remember you and bear you in its thoughts. If there's one thing that I hope everyone in Barbados remembers, it's about Neville Rowe. It is this. Neville loved and cared about people. His smile was never greater than when customers hugged him. He liked a good joke or a funny story. And if he ever got the upper hand on you, God help you. I will miss Neville. We recently worked on commercials for Prestige Gift Solutions. I believe that Neville could have been a talented director. Quite frankly, Neville could have been anything he wanted to be. He had a lot of ideas, which my team and I benefited from. Whether you know it or not, he had a lot of ideas that you have benefited from as well. We extend our sympathy to the family on behalf of my team. Moses Dear, Annette Dear, Lisa Bourne, David Harris, Desmond King, Justin King, Tremaine Rowe, Cassandra Crawford, Cindy Rouse, and Joel Ford. Rest in peace, my friend. It's time to trade that white shirt and black pants for a pair of wings. Fly high, my brother. Fly high.
Good afternoon, everyone. I usually prefer not to use paper, but, and don't be disturbed by the amount of paper I have, the print is large. So I thought I would pen a letter to Neville. So this is my letter to Neville. Dear Neville, when we met with your son Tremaine at my daughter's cafe, The Park, in Perone Village a couple months ago, little did I know then that it would be the last time I would see you. There is much I would have asked had I known then that we would not meet again. So, since I'm hoping that our next meeting can be delayed as long as possible, I thought I would reminisce a bit and posit some unanswered questions. What was it that brought you and I together as friends? I really don't recall how that friendship started or why, but I know it was a sort of mutual admiration society. What was it that made you, the resolute, some might say, stubborn man you were, uncompromising on the things you stood for? You believe that no one should ever be late for work. If you have to be at work for 7 o'clock, you can't wake up at 6 o'clock for the 6 o'clock bus. No, you wake up at 4 a.m. and catch the 5 a.m. bus. Those words you said to Mervyn Lynch on more than one occasion. Neville, why did you choose me to voice every single Julien advertisement or any other, but especially the Julien advertisements for radio and TV, so that today friends who have nothing to do go on YouTube and send me the rapid fire ads I did back then for Julien just to torment me a little bit? What was it that drove you so relentlessly day by day, year by year, to become the leading supermarket operator of the day? What was it that you saw in the Bridge Street store operation that that business giant of the day, Barbados Shipping and Trading, didn't see? I recall you telling me it was the best supermarket location in Barbados. BS&T didn't agree, but you proved them wrong. When I asked, but Neville, where will the customers park? You sniggered and looked at me stupidly, as if to say, well, stupidity, as we say in Trinidad, with your dismissive reply, Vic Fernandes, you're becoming too middle class. Parking? I have 5 bus stands in walking distance. My customers don't drive cars. Good dear Neville. You could have told me that privately and not in front of Mohammed Said Kofdawala, who laughed heartily at me. That was not the only time you made me look small. No mean achievement, I might add. I recall the night of the fire at Bridge Street. You and the said same Mohammed Said came over to River Road to my office for a meeting with me while the fire was still raging and we were all standing outside looking at it. And when I said to you, but Neville, shouldn't you be in Bridge Street? You reminded me you were not a fireman and therefore of no value over there. You further informed me that you had already met with Selby Rose and Mapp architects on the design of the new Bridge Street building and that containers were being packed as we spoke for the reopening of the temporary Julien store, which would open, and it did, in 1 week's time. You were alleged to be inflexible and uncompromising, but do you know that I saw the soft side of you? I recall an incident at the Bridge Street store where an old lady was held for shoplifting. Your policy was all shoplifters hand them over to the police. The old lady was shivering with fright, and she came up to you begging for a break. And when I intervened and opened my big mouth and said to you, but Neville, she's old enough to be your grandmother, give her a break. Your blunt response was, Vic Fernandes, my grandmother is not a thief. I was relentless, and eventually you caved and released the old lady without calling the police. That day, I saw the softer side of Neville Rowe. May I remind you, Neville, when you and the Julien brand took St. Lucia by storm as you opened a branch at the Gable Woods Mall on the John Compton Highway, until then, St. Lucia did not have anything that resembled a truly modern supermarket. You revolutionized the supermarket business there. I recall you, me, Saeed, Merville Lynch, and the late Frank Grimes spending a few days shooting film and negotiating advertising rates, which I requested that you let me handle, and you did. The day before the opening, there was a buzz, and people kept peering in to see what was about to happen. I recall a rich American lady, well, I assume she was rich because she lived in Cap Estate, begging to be let in. I suggested that you let her in to shop. Your response was, Vic, why you don't stick to broadcasting? We don't have point-of-sale systems working yet, so we can't accommodate her. On this occasion, Neville, I got the better of you as I responded, but Neville, you're becoming too middle class. You forget when you used to use a calculator to arrive at prices? You let the lady in finally, another concession. She spent thousands of dollars while saying, I've been waiting for years in St. Lucia for a real supermarket. You did that, Neville, you, Saeed, and your amazing team. And do you remember that for days after the opening, police had to come and help regulate the crowds, and at times the doors had to be closed because the numbers were just too much to handle? Do you recall that? I do. St. Lucia owes you a great debt. Because of you, the supermarket business was transformed overnight. And I recall when you made the difficult decision, in the interest of your staff, to sell the branch after yet another armed robbery. I recall also Michael Chastanet telling me, and that's the former Prime Minister's father who you sold to, that even though he knew nothing of the supermarket business, that it was one of the greatest gifts he had ever got, and that he would rebrand it to Julien's, as that was the way St. Lucians pronounced Julien. Michael also jokingly, I said, told me he was planning to open a Kentucky fried chicken, which again is the way how the Lucians pronounce Kentucky. Thankfully, I think he was only joking. You were unquestionably ahead of your time. Investing as Merville Lynch reminded me when we spoke a few days ago from Cayman in setting up their own studio. You've heard a lot about that, with state-of-the-art equipment to produce your own ads and material and so on. That was so revolutionary a decision that even by today's standards, few businesses have taken such a direct control of their marketing. I got just a couple more questions for you, Neville, before I go. What was your fascination with the white shirts and the black pants? I could never get over it. Merville tells me that whenever he traveled with you, you would go into a store and buy 24 of the same style white shirts. Same style every time, 24 shirts. Have you ever worn any other colors other than white shirts and black pants? Only Tremaine could tell us that in the assorted ties. Did you have any other color shirts or even shorts in your wardrobe? How come you never built a big mansion on the hill somewhere but preferred to reside where you always did in Baxter's Road? And what was it about the Honda Legend that made you own that car and only that kind of car? Lastly, Neville, I want to say this to you. You always paid me a retainer monthly, whether I recorded one ad or 50 ads. Shrewd negotiator that you were, I now wonder how come you accepted my offer so readily. Looking back, I suspect you got the better bargain. Not so? I think you did. You were small in stature, but larger than life. Your place is guaranteed in the history of Bajan and Caribbean business. Let us meet up again sometime, my friend, but no rush. No rush. I can wait.
At this time, I would like to give honor and recognition to the Honorable Prime Minister of Barbados, Mayor Amar Motley. And now we will have the next tribute.
over there are mansions prepared just for me, where I will live with my Savior.
Beautiful rendition, and we look forward for the day when there will be no more night, no more pain, no more dying, no more coming to occasions like these, but to be ever with the Lord. We're going to have the second Bible lesson reading, St. John's Gospel, chapter 14, 1 through 6, and that will be read by Mrs. Bonnie Springer, and after that we have the hymn, Blessed Assurance. Let us stand for the reading of God's word.
Good afternoon, everyone. Let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. And whither I go, you know, and the way you know. Thomas said unto him, Lord, we know not whither thou goest, and how can we know the way? Jesus said unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. Here ends the reading. Thanks be to God.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of love. Born of his spirit, washed in his blood. This is my story. This is my story.
You may be seated. I speak to you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the blessed Holy Spirit. Lord, let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. I speak to you from the last lesson that was read, St. John 14, 1 through 6, and also verses 27, and it reads, "Let not your hearts be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also." And verse 27 says, "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give unto you. Not as the world giveth, give I unto you. Let not your hearts be troubled." This chapter is a comforting and enlightening discourse by Jesus with his disciples during the Last Supper. He sets himself to comfort the others who were filled with sorrow upon what he had said of leaving them. St. John 13, verse 1 also says, "It was just before the Passover feast. Jesus knew that the time had come for him to leave this world and to go back to his Father." And with the thought of Jesus leaving them, having been there with them all along, no doubt his disciples became troubled in heart. Losing a loved one is never easy. It can be one of the most painful experiences, and I'm saying this from experience, because I've lost over the years many of my loved ones. One of the most painful experiences that you will ever have to endure, whether it's a close friend, a spouse, a parent, one can feel very overwhelming. And you may even experience waves of intense and very difficult emotions ranging from sadness, emptiness, and despair. You may even find it difficult to accept the person if they are really gone. It leaves our hearts hurt and broken. And it is in times like these we need comfort from the Word of God. Jesus knew that his disciples, how they felt, and with these comfortable words, he responds to their anxiety by saying, "Let not your hearts be troubled." The word there, "be troubled," comes from the Greek word terasso, which means to be disturbed, to be shaken, to be anxious, to be distressed, or take away the calmness of mind. But here Jesus calls them back to this fundamental relationship of trust and assures them that he is not abandoning them. And I want to say at this point this evening, though this might be a very difficult hour for all of us, I want to say to us, do not let your hearts be troubled. Jesus here is saying, he's not telling us that we will not feel grief, we will not feel hurt. But what he is saying to us through this word is, do not allow it to overwhelm us. We must come to that point, even though it is hard, that we be able to manage and to be able to go through in the days and even in the years to come. He says to them, "You believe in God, believe also in me." Put your trust in God. Put your trust in me. I want to say, in the midst of their fear and confusion, Jesus urges the disciples to find comfort in their faith. And it is in difficult times like these, the challenges of life, that we need a faith in God. A faith in God that will strengthen us
to take us through life's challenges, because I want to let us know we cannot do it on our own. We need someone bigger than us. And whether we believe or not, his name is God, the creator of all creators, the one who made the heavens and the earth, the one who spoke and it came into being, the one who commanded and it stood fast, the one who have all of us here this evening alive. It is in him that we need to find that strength as we put our faith in him. The call to trust in God and in Jesus is not merely intellectual affirmation, but a heartfelt is in the divine care and protection. It is something that is experienced, something that you come to know, and you do that by asking Jesus to come into your heart to accept him. And I heard our sister Esther in her opening remarks this evening encourage us, if we have not done so, we need to do it as soon as possible, because life is fleeting. We do not know the day or the hour. We could be here today, and tomorrow we are in eternity. And we must make sure that we do not leave this earth just like that. We must make sure that we are prepared for eternity. Faith and trust in God calm our troubled hearts by anchoring us in the unshakable promises and love of God. As we trust in Jesus, we can find solace in the assurance that he is with us through every storm, providing the strength, the guidance, and the comfort that we so need. When we are confronted with uncertainty and fear, this faith, this trust that I'm talking about in Jesus reminds us that we are never alone. He is, according to Psalm 46, he is our refuge and our strength. He is a very present help in time of trouble. Faith and trust in Jesus shifts our focus from all our circumstances to the eternal perspective of God's kingdom. When we place our trust in Jesus, we acknowledge that our trials and tribulations are temporary, and that the ultimate victory is already secured through Jesus Christ's sacrifice on the cross. You believe in God? He says, believe also in me. This trust gives us a hope that brings calmness to our hearts and helps us to endure even in the most difficult situations as we rest in the certainty of God's unwavering love and fullness. Jesus assured them of the place, the promise, and the peace. The place, he says, in my Father's house, there are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I am going to prepare a place for you, a place that there will be no more death, no more sorrow, no more crying, no more pain. We are reminded in the book of Revelation, chapter 21, verse 4, and God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow, nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain. That place that Jesus have gone to prepare for us. The book of Revelation reminds us, for the former things are passed away. We thank God this evening for that comfort, because if we only had hope in this world, we, according to scripture, will be men most miserable. But we thank God for the hope that is found in Christ Jesus. Not only does he promise us a place, but he gives to us that eternal promise. He says, I will come back and I will take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. We read in the book of Acts, chapter 1, verses 11, when Jesus was ascending into heaven, going back to his Father, we read that the angel says, ye men of Galilee, why stand ye gazing up into heaven? This same Jesus, which is taken up from you in heaven, shall also come in like manner as you have seen him go into heaven. So this is the promise, that as he went, he is also coming again. And I want for us to bear that in mind in our spirits this evening. Many of us are not giving full thought to it, but the promise that he made that he would return, he surely will. He is coming again. In 1 Thessalonians 4, 16 to 17 reminds us, for the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel, and with the song of the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first, and then we who are alive, who are left, will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so we will always be with the Lord. This is the promise. This is the promise that Jesus gave to us. He said, I'm going to prepare a place for you, that where I am, there ye may be also. And the promises of God, according to scripture, they are yea, they are true. For we serve a God that is not a man that he should lie, neither the son of man that he should repent. Have he said, and will he not do it? He will surely bring it to pass. For those who have our faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, this give us an eternal hope to hold on, even in these difficult moments. We're living in some serious, uncertain times. And the signs of the times are everywhere, whether we want to believe it or not, that the return of Jesus Christ is inevitable. And so that is telling us that we should put our lives into perspective, and that we should make preparation to meet him. You know, somebody says, when I die, I die. I just go back to the earth. But the Bible tells us differently. The soul lives on. The spirit returns to God who give it. And the scripture also reminds us it is appointed. There is an appointment that we cannot shift. You know, we have our various appointments in life. Dentist appointment, doctor's appointment, and various appointments. We can call and say, well, I'm not coming today. But this appointment, when it comes, you cannot turn it away. It is an appointment that we all have to face. And it says, it's appointed unto man once to die. We only have one life, and we should ensure that we live this life to the honor and to the glory of Almighty God. Because after death, there is a judgment. Each of us, I know we live in different times now. Some don't believe that God exists. But each of us will have to stand before God and give an account of the things that we have done in these bodies, whether to be good or whether to be bad. But the most important thing, our goodness will not save us. It is having a blessed assurance, having God in our hearts, knowing that we have served him and give him here on earth our time. Because it's only what have been done for Christ is what will last. He does not only give a promise, but I thank God this evening he has given to us a peace. I can't get it explained, but I've been through my storms of life as well, of losing loved ones. I don't know how he does it. But he's able to give you a peace that passeth all understanding. Somebody give the Lord praise. A peace that passeth all human understanding. I don't know how he does it. We don't know how we get through. But God gives us his peace. A peace that the world cannot give. Certainly the world cannot take away. I am challenging everyone this evening. You will not find peace in this world. The only peace that you can find is in the Lord Jesus Christ. You know, when I was growing up as a child, I thought peace meant, in my younger days, everything calm, everything's going to be all right. But I've learned it could be chaos. It could be storms. It could be what? As long as you have a peace in God, you can sail through the storms. You can sail through the storms.
And this peace I offer this evening to the family, that though this is a difficult time for you and for all of us who have come to give of our support, I pray that God will give you that peace, that inner strength to carry on and to go through these difficult moments. He says in St. John 14:27, "Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. I do not give as the world gives." And I hear that the world gives you peace today, and they come back by tomorrow, and they take it back. "Do not let your hearts be troubled." God gives a comforting peace to those with a broken heart. Peace is sitting in that comfort and knowing that God is with you no matter what. Somebody can praise God for that. No matter what comes my way in life, there's a peace of God that gives us that solace, that assurance to know, though it's hard, it's going to be all right. We will come through this. The peace which transcends all understanding, it is the harmony and calmness of the body and of the mind and the spirit, trusting in the power and the grace of God. I remember Paul in his experience, he says, the Lord ministered to him. He said, "My grace is sufficient for you." He did not take away. And I have learned something in life, that God doesn't take away the pain. The pain is there for a purpose. But he comforts us through that pain. That's why the word says, "Blessed is the God of all comfort, who comfort us through our tribulation." That as we come through, we will have an experience that we will be able to be in the place to comfort others. I can stand here this evening and I can say to you, you will come through this. It is going to be all right. God will strengthen you, because I've been there. I know what it is. God's peace is not only for today. It is permanent and it is secure, because he is the Prince of Peace. God's peace is built on the foundation of his word. And then from further research, I understand that this peace comes through Jesus, and it speaks of a completeness. It speaks of nothing missing, nothing broken. And that is the peace that God gives to us. And it speaks of being whole in your spirit. That is the kind of peace we want, we desire from God as we meet head on the challenges of this life. On the other hand, I said the world offers a peace that is fleeting and it changes with circumstances. The world's peace is built on a weak foundation of compromise. The world's peace ignores the root of the problem. But in Isaiah 26 verse 3 tells us, "You will keep him in perfect peace whose mind is steadfast because he trusts in you." You believe in God? Jesus said, "Believe also in me, for he has promised to give us peace," because he has been here before. He is our great high priest who can be touched with the feeling of our infirmities. And he will carry you through. Family, he will carry you through. Loved ones, supporters who are bearing this grief, he will carry us through. 1 Peter 5:7 reminds us, "Casting all of your care, casting all of your anxiety upon him." Why? Because he cares for you. We have a God who cares. He says he will not leave us nor forsake us, but he be with us even to the end. And so as we grieve this evening, as we sorrow, let us take consolation from the word of God. Let us gather that strength from God's word, that comfort. Let us let this peace of God rule in our hearts. And this peace will be able to take us through, as I said, for the days to come. It will not be easy, the weeks, the months, as we know that every person grieves differently, even the years to come.
In St. John 16:33, he said, I have told you these things so that in me you may have peace. In this world you will have trouble, but take heart, take courage. I have overcome the world. And if Jesus have overcome the world, we too will overcome. Because his promise, because I overcame, you too will overcome. This is the hope, this is the consolation that we have, that we place in this God, that we put our trust. And I pray this evening that these few words will be a source of comfort, of strength. I know one thing for sure, that we will be there for you. We will continue to support you in our praise, that God will strengthen you in this very difficult time. Let us stand as we sing the final hymn, Blessed Assurance. Sorry. My apologies. To God be the glory.
Thank you.
Lord, thou hast been our dwelling place in all generations. Before the mountains were brought forth, or ever thou hast formed the earth and the world, even from everlasting thou art God. Thou turnest man to destruction and say, return ye children of men. For 1,000 years in thy sight are but yesterday, when it is past, and as a watch in the night. Thou carriest them away with a flood, and they are as asleep. In the morning it flourisheth and groweth up. In the evening it is cut down and withereth. For we are consumed in thy anger, and by thy wrath we are troubled. Thou hast set our iniquities before thee, our secret sins in the light of thy countenance. For all our days are passed in thy wrath. We spend our years as a tale that is told. The days of our years are 80 years. And if by reason of strength there be 80 years, yet in their strength labor and sorrow, for I soon cut off and we fly away. Who knoweth the power of thy anger, even according to thy fear, so is thy wrath. So teach us to number our days, that we may apply our hearts to wisdom. Let us pray. O God of life, as we have learned to do in all of our experiences, we come to you in the hour of death. We know that you love us and that you can turn even the shadow of death into light of morning. Help us now to wait before you with reverent and submissive hearts. Make this a time of opening of our eyes and our understanding, and a time of admonition to our hearts and soul. Bless those who feel this sorrow most kingly, and cause the bonds of Christian love to bind us closer together, so that we may share with them that spiritual strength and that faith in God which is ours through the love of Jesus, whose name we pray. Amen. For as much as it pleased Almighty God, in his wise providence, to take out of the world the soul of Neville Sylvester Rowe, we now therefore commit his body to the ground. Earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust, looking for the resurrection of the body and the life of our world to come. Through Jesus Christ, at whose second coming, in glorious majesty to judge the world, the sea and the dead shall give up the dead and corruptible bodies of those who sleep in him, shall be changed and made like unto his glorious body, according to the mighty working whereby he is able to subdue all things unto himself. The Lord's Prayer. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us of our trespasses,
As we forgive those that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The hymn, O Lord, my God, how great thou art. It is well with my soul.
Oh,
When the roll is called up yonder, our next hymn, When the Roll is Called Up Yonder. Next hymn in the suite, By and By.
Sing on that beautiful shore the melodious songs of the blessed, and our spirit shall sorrow no more, not a sigh for the blessing of rest.
In the sweet
by and by
we shall meet on that beautiful shore.
in the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. We will offer a tribute.
Yeah, you're welcome, you're welcome.
That's where his mother is, my mom. Thanks very much, sir. I appreciate this, and I say thank you.
On the behalf of the family of Neville Sylvester Rowe, we would like to thank all of you for coming and giving of your support here this evening in this service. Before I do the benediction, we will now have an instrumental. As we leave the form of our dear loved one, I pray that the comfort of God and Father and the Lord Jesus Christ and the abiding presence of the Holy Spirit be with those who sorrow. The Lord bless thee and keep thee. The Lord make his face to shine upon thee and be gracious unto thee. The Lord lift up his countenance upon thee and give thee peace. May the soul of our dear loved one, Neville Sylvester Rowe, rest in peace.
Show me how to do it, y'all.
In you.
didn't know today would be your last, or that I'd have to say goodbye to you so fast. I'm so numb I can't feel anymore. I'm praying you'd just walk back through that door and tell me that I was only dreaming. You're not really gone as long as I believe. There will be another angel around the throne tonight. Love lives on inside of me, and I will hold on tight. It's not my place to question, only God knows why. I'm just jealous of the angels around the throne tonight. Always made my troubles feel so small, and you were always there to catch me when I'd fall. In a world where heroes come and go, well, God just took the only one I know. So I'll hold you as close as I can, longing for the day when I see your face again. But until then, God must need another angel around the throne tonight. Your love lives on inside of me, and I will hold on tight. It's not my place to question.
Crucified, laid behind a stone. You live to die, rejected and alone. Like a rose trampled on the ground, you took the fall and thought of me above all. High cross trampled on the ground, you took the fall and thought of me above all.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship His holy name. The sun goes down, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song.